morning, students. Myself, Dr. Apeeksha Dole, professor, oral medicine and radiology, currently working at VSPM Dental College and Hospital. Today, I'll be the mentor for lecture, Normal Radiographic Anatomic Landmark. Now, I know the normal landmark we have dealt, maxillomandibular landmark we have dealt in the first year, and the tooth landmark we have learnt in the third year. So, the landmark part we know, but how they appear radiographically is important, and that will be dealt in this lecture. Now, why it is important to know? Because unless and until you know the normal landmark, you cannot know the pathology, where exactly the pathology lies. The teeth are composed primarily of dentine with enamel. Now, this is a tooth structure which is composed of enamel, dentine, cementum. That is, the coronal part is covered with the enamel and the dentine which is inside it, and the radicular part is composed of dentine and covered with a thin layer of cementum. What is it appears? Can you see this is an enamel part, this is a dentine part which is present in the coronally, and the radicular dentine and the rest of the part. Now, these are the structures which we are going to consider in the next topics. Now, before we go, again, this is a two-dimensional image. This is a two-dimensional image which we are going to see in the radiograph, and the tooth is a three-dimensional object. The three-dimensional object and the image is visualized, which is two-dimensional. Only two colors, one is white, another is black. The white is radio-opaque, that is radio-opaque, or the more dense structures appears radio-opaque or white, and the radiolucent, or you can say the black, the appears the soft tissue, or the dense less dense structures will appear radiolucent. Now, coming to the first enamel cap, it appears more radio opaque as it is highly dense structure. Then lesser than that is the dentine, which is 75% mineralized, and then comes the cementum. Now, when we say cementum, cementum is very thin layer which is surrounding the radicular dentine. Now, it is 50% mineralized. That means it has to appear on the radiograph as a radio opacity, but it won't appear. Though it appear, we cannot appreciate the radio opacity because it is very thin, and the radio opacity cannot be differentiated from the dentine and the surrounding alveolar bone. Now comes the radiolucent part, that is pulp tissue. Can you see this radiograph with the radiolucent structures? Now, these radiolucencies which are present, which are wherever I am showing my cursor. Now, this radiolucent part in the middle of the tooth, it is composed of a soft tissue and so appears as a radiolucent. Pulp chambers and root canals extend from the interior of a chamber till the root apices. An apical foramen is also recognizable, and it is necessary to recognize the root canals, because whenever you are doing the RCT, this pulp chamber and RCT and the apical foramen plays major role. Now, cervical burnout. Now, cervical burnout is not any radiolucency or radioopacity. It is just an it is not a landmark. It is not a landmark, I'm saying, but it is appears on the radiograph because of some virtual effects. Now, how and when these virtual effects will cause these radiolucencies? Now, radiograph sometimes shows diffuse radiolucent areas that are ill-defined and are present. This is the alveolar crest, and this is the enamel cap. Now, this middle part on the tooth appears as a ill-defined radiolucent structures, and this is present not only on the single tooth, will present on the another tooth also. Now, these radiolucencies, which are not a part of any pathology, not a part of any normal radiolucent landmark, but appears on the tooth which are present on that particular radiograph because of the effect. Now, when this cervical burnout actually appears, there are certain reasons, like normal configuration of the affected tooth, which results in the decreased X-ray absorption in the areas. when particularly the teeth which are showing, these cervical burnout will be having sharp curve in this particular area, and perception of these radiolucent areas results from the contrast with the adjacent radio-opaque bone and the enamel. Now, the adjacent structures are bone and the enamel. They are highly dense structures, and when you compare these structures, you are perceiving the radiolucency. And so, though there is no pathology, the cervical burnout, if sometimes appears, you have to consider in the normal variation in the landmark part. You don't have to consider it as a pathology. Now, normally the supporting structures are lamina dura, alveolar crest, periodontal ligament space, and the cancellous bone. We'll see one by one. Lamina dura. Now, lamina dura, lamina is a hard layer. Lamina dura, the literal meaning of it. Now, what is this hard layer? We all know the tooth is present in the bony socket. Now, this bony socket is made up of a cancellous, the cortical bone present in the cancellous bone. And this is all the alveolar bone, which is a cancellous bone. And inside this, this is a cortical bone, which is the lamina dura. Now, lamina dura is a radiographic term. We never say anatomically or the pathologically. This is a radiographic term, lamina dura, because it appears a thin radio-opaque line. A thin radio-opaque layer which appears in the radiograph, it surrounds the tooth. Now, this bone is again, why this appears so much of radio-opacity? The radiographic appearance is due to the attenuation of X-ray beam as it passes tangentially through the thickness of bone. The thickness of bone, which gives when the rays goes tangentially, makes the appearance of more radio opaque, and so the layer appears more radio opaque, and so the term is lamina dura. It is thicker than the surrounding trabecular bone, and its thickness increases with the increase in the amount of occlusal stress. The amount increases, and so the thickness increases. Now, this lamina dura intactness is very important. Intact lamina dura says that the tooth is vital, and if there is loss of lamina dura, you have to check for any pathology. Most of the time, the lamina dura, if there is loss of lamina dura, we think it for a periapical pathologies. Then alveolar crest. Now, we are considering this alveolar crest. Now, it is a radio-opaque gingival margin of the alveolar process. This is a gingival margin of the alveolar process which surrounds the teeth. It is considered that if it is 1.5 mm or less than the CE junction. Now, considered this junction. Now, this is when it is normal, when it is 1.5 cm below the CE junction. That is, this is the normal width, but if it is below that, you have to consider for the abnormalities. It is pointed in the anterior region, but as you go in the posterior region, it will become flat. You can see this flat in the posterior region, but in the anterior region, it will be pointed or triangular. And can you see the angle which is formed? Usually, it is the right angle which is formed. And if it goes round off, you can say there is a periodontitis. Because of the periodontitis, there is rounding of the alveolar crest. And so it plays a very major role. Can you see this? This is an alveolar crest. The periodontal ligament space. Now it is composed. We all know the tooth. It is present in the socket. But what lies in between the tooth and the socket? They are the periodontal ligament fibers. Not only the periodontal ligament fibers, but all the blood vessels and all these things. Now, it is composed of collagen, so appears as a radiolucent space. Space, that is a shadow which appears as a space, that is a radiolucent one. The thickness of periodontal ligament varies from patient to patient, from tooth to tooth, and even from location around the tooth. This is very important, because when I know that there are variations, I'll find out the variations in that radiolucency. And so I should know where exactly the variations, when the variations will be. Now it is thinner in the middle part and slightly wider near the alveolar crest and the apex. That is above and below it will be slightly wider, but in the middle it will be thinner. And so you have to consider whenever you are dealing with the interpretation of these periodontal ligament space interpretation. Can you see the radiolucent thin line which is present? You can also appreciate the thinness is wider on the mesial aspect as compared to the distal aspect. Now, cancellous bone, as already told, the tooth which is the alveolar bone which is there, the surrounding the tooth is the cancellous bone. Now, the trabeculae bone, it is also called as trabecular bone or the spongiosa. It lies between the cortical plates in both the jaws. Now, it is composed of a thin radiopaque plates and the rods surrounding many radiolucent pockets of marrow. That is, they are surrounded by the marrow spaces. Posterior maxilla, it is similar to the anterior, but the marrow spaces are larger as compared to the anterior one. Now, coming to the anatomic landmark of the maxilla, now here is a list and we will go one by one. Intermaxillary suture, anterior nasal spine. Here I have considered all the landmarks from anterior region to the posterior region. Okay, students, the nasal aperture, incisive foramen, superior foramina of nasopalatine canal, lateral fossa, nose, nasolacrimal canal, maxillary sinus, zygomatic process and zygomatic bone, nasolabial fold and pterygoids. You don't have to worry that there are so much of list of the zygomatic of the anatomic landmarks. There are mixed in the list. There are radiolucent as well as radio opaque landmarks, plus there are certain soft tissue landmarks also. Now, you all know from the anterior region, I'm going to the posterior region. Just have in your mind what are the normal anatomic landmarks in these areas, and we'll have remember all these landmarks. Now, coming to the first is the intermaxillary suture. Now, intermaxillary, the maxilla is sutured, the intermaxillary suture. This is a suture line which is in between the two maxillary bone. Now, how the suture appears? The maxilla will appear radio opaque, but the suture line will appear radiolucent. It is also called as median suture. In IOPA, it appears as a thin radiolucent line limited by two radiopaque borders. Now, these two radiopaque borders, they are of a maxilla. Borders of a thin cortical bone in the midline between the two portions of premaxilla. Now, it extends from alveolar crest. Now, here is the alveolar crest between the central incisors superiorly through the anterior nasal spine and continues posteriorly between the maxillary palatine process of a posterior aspect of the hard palate. Now, here the anatomy I have considered from where to where it is going anteriorly and to the posterior extension. How it appears on the radiograph from the alveolar crest up to the anterior nasal spine. You can see very well appreciate this radiolucent line, and there are two surrounding radiopaque borders. The two radiopaque borders, they are naturally of the maxillary bone, premaxillary bone, and the radiolucent line. This radiolucent line, which is of our concern, is intermaxillary suture. Now, anterior nasal spine. Can you see this radio-opaque structure? This radio-opaque or bony structure, you can see. This is a bony structure. And so on the radiograph, you can see there is a radio-opacity. Mostly in the central part of the maxillary incisors and located 1.5 cm to 2 cm above the alveolar crest. We have already dealt with the intermaxillary suture. It is extending up to this alveolar crest. You can also very well appreciate this outline here also. And it is V-shaped radio opacity. It is actually a V-shaped radio opacity present above 2 cm above the alveolar crest. the nasal aperture and nasal septum. As we all know, just this is a diagrammatic representation. We'll first come to this diagrammatic representation. These are two central incisors. This was the intermaxillary suture and this was the anterior nasal spine. Above to this, there is a nasal septum. These two areas, they are the nasal cavity, and this obliquely goes is an anterior floor of nasal fossa. This is nasal fossa and this is an anterior floor of nasal fossa. Okay, now can you have this diagram? This picture clearly says this is a nasal septum, this is nasal concha. You can have these are the nasal fossas. Now on periapical radiograph of incisor, the inferior border of a nasal fossa aperture as a radio opaque line. Fossa though appears as a radiolucency, but the borders they appears as a radio opaque line and extends bilaterally away from the base of anterior nasal spine. This is anterior nasal spine. They are going obliquely as a radio opaque line from the base. The radio opaque nasal septum arises in the midline from the anterior nasal spine. Okay. Now nasal concha, can you see these are the nasal concha? The nasal cavity contains a radio opaque shadow of the inferior concha. These concha feel varying amount of a lateral portion of the cavity. You can have this is a nasal cavity, and you can have this is a nasal concha. Now incisive foramen. We have gone through this landmark, but now we are going to see in between what lies. It is also called as nasopalatine or anterior palatine foramen. It is the oral terminus of a nasopalatine canal transmitting the nasopalatine vessels and nerves. Appears as a ovoid radiolucent image. Now it is a foramen. Now foramen appears as a radiolucency surrounding by the radio opacity. Okay. Now this incisive foramen, it lies in between the maxillary central incisor. It is considered that it is round, ovoid, and if the shadow of anterior nasal spine, it appears on that, it may sometime appears as a heart-shaped radiolucency. Now radiographic images, there are variability because of different angulations of the X-ray beam and because of presence of certain superimpositions. Now the size of the incisive foramen, it should be below the 1 centimeter. It should be below 1 centimeter. But if you are saying the size is bigger, you have to consider that there is something cystic transformation in the incisive foramen. Can you appreciate this is a radiolucency which is present? Now most of the time this radiolucency is in the either extending from middle half of the root to 1 to 2 centimeter. In this particular area, you may have this radiolucency. Now, superior foramina of a nasopalatine canal. We already dealt with nasopalatine canal. It originates at the two foramina in the floor of nasal cavity. Here, in the oral cavity, it arises as a incisive foramen. But here in the nasal cavity, there are two foramina and appears as a superior foramina. The openings are on each side of the nasal septum, close to the antero-inferior border of a nasal cavity. Radiographically, it can be recognized as a two radiolucent. Again, these are foramina and so appears as a radiolucency surrounded by the radiopaque borders. Now, radiographically, they can be recognized as a two radiolucent areas above the apices of central incisor in the floor of nasal cavity. This is actually the occlusal view, but when we have the IOP radiographic view, these are two central incisors, this will be the incisive foramen, and these are the canals or the walls, we can say. These are the walls of nasopalatine canal, and we'll have the two foramina in this particular area. And those foramina are superior foramina of a nasopalatine canal. Coming to the next landmark, it is the lateral fossa. Again, we all have seen the skull. We can see the canine will have the prominence. But below the, above the apices of the lateral incisor and mesial to the canine, there will be depression. Okay, and this gentle depression in the maxilla near the apex of lateral incisal will appear radiographically as a diffuse radiolucency. We can appreciate the radiolucency, which was not what I have shown you the earlier radiolucencies. Now this is a diffuse radiolucency because there is nothing soft tissue over here. This is just a depression. There is no pathology lines. Now how can we say that there is no pathology? We have to concentrate on the lamina dura of this particular tooth. Now radiolucency surrounding the lateral incisor may be because of a periapical pathology which is arises from the lateral incisor when it gets affected. It is periapical abscess, periapical cyst or periapical granuloma like radiolucencies. But how I am going to differentiate from those radiolucencies? I have to go on tracing the lamina dura. But if the lamina dura is intact, my tooth is vital and there is no periapical pathology, and whatever this radiolucency is appearing is nothing but the normal radiographic landmark, that is lateral fossa. Nose. We all know this is nose. How this nose appears on the radiograph? Now we have again go on a projection geometry. The IOPA film we are going to place inside the oral cavity and your X-ray beam will be above. Whatever will come in the line of X-ray beam will be projected on the X-ray film. And so if someone is having a sharper, the long nose, or your angulation is above the tip of the nose, the nose shadow may appear on the apices of this central incisor. Can you see this is the shadow? Again, this shadow is slightly radio opaque and is having a border. This is a sharp border, and you have to consider this. You don't have to confuse it with the fracture line, because this is very common landmark. The shadow of nose, you can have the shadow of upper lip also in the anterior region. Can you see this is a shadow of nose in the root portion in the apical third region, and sometimes you may get on the incisal surface that will be the shadow of upper lip. No, nasolacrimal canal. Before I have this, can you know the nasolacrimal canal? What is the canal? This is a lacrimal gland. This lacrimal gland, that is the tear gland, and this is a lacrimal duct. This duct passes through the nasolacrimal canal. This nasolacrimal canal, then it opens in the nasal cavity. Now we have a certain text like nasal and maxillary bone forms the nasolacrimal canal. It runs from the medial aspect of anterior inferior border of the orbit inferiorly to drain under the inferior concha into the nasal cavity. That is, it doesn't open into the oral cavity, into the nasal cavity. Now how it appears or when it appears on the IOP radiograph? We'll have a look. Usually it appears on the occlusal radiograph. Now it appears as a foramen. It appears as a foramen. It is a vertical landmark, but as we are taking a radiograph, as we are shooting, the central ray is from above. We can see only the foramen. Cross-sectional area will be visible and not the vertical line. We can see the foramen over here. Are you getting my point? We are not getting the complete canal, but as the foramen we are seeing, because we are seeing it vertically from the top. If you are seeing the tunnel, how it appears only as a foramen. And so in the occlusal radiograph you can have the foramen like structure only, and in an IOPA radiograph, this is an IOPA radiograph, when your vertical angulation is very stiff, increase in the vertical angulation will give rise to the nasolacrimal canal appeared as a foramen above the apices or in the premolar region. Routinely it can be seen in the maxillary occlusal projection in the molar region. Then maxillary sinus. We all know the maxilla is having the air cavity, and they are the maxillary sinuses. Now it is largest of all the paranasal sinuses, it is of three-sided pyramid base on the medial wall adjacent to the nasal cavity, apex laterally to the zygomatic process of maxilla. The three sides, the superior wall, the floor of orbit, anterior wall extending above the premolar, and posterior wall above molars and maxillary tuberosity. This, the anatomical part of a maxillary sinus, we all have in the anatomical lectures. Now, how appears it on the radiograph? Now, which radiograph it will be appear in the molar premolar area? Can you see? Now, this is a premolar, these are molars, and these are 7 and 8. This thin line, thin radiopaque line, which is covering the root apices, and this is a floor of maxillary sinus. Maxillary sinus, it contains air and it appears radiolucent, but it is present in the maxilla, and hence the floor of the maxillary sinus will appear as a radiopaque structure. Now, the structure of a maxillary sinus, it depends upon the age as well as in the gender, as well as when the tooth, when it is dentulous and when it is edentulous. This floor of maxillary sinus, the position of maxillary sinus, floor of maxillary sinus will be somewhat at the alveolar region. It will be inferiorly placed if there are no tooth or when it is an edentulous region. Y line of Ennis. This is a inverted Y-shaped structure we'll get in the canine premolar region. Now, can you see this is a canine? This is canine. This is a lateral incisor. This is premolar. This is second premolar. And we can have this structure which is appearing as an inverted Y structure. Anteriorly, what might be the structure? This is an inferior border of nasal fossa. This is an inferior border of nasal fossa, and it is somewhat thicker as compared to the thin radiopaque line, which is a floor of maxillary sinus. And so this is a point of interaction, and it is very important when we identify the tooth in the edentulous area, when there are no tooth structure, but you can if you have this structure, you can identify the radiograph by knowing that this structure appears in the canine premolar region. Now, if I have this, zygomatic process. Now, zygomatic process, that is malar process, malar prominence. Now, that appears as a U-shaped radio opacity on the apices of maxillary molars. And we can have this extension of this inferior portion of the zygomatic process may be appears as a zygomatic process. This is zygomatic bone and zygomatic process. We all have seen that there are nasolabial folds. Now, when these nasolabial folds are prominent, yes, it is in the old age. As the patient gets more older, the patient may have this nasolabial folds becomes prominent, and sometimes on the radiograph of the canine premolar region, you will get more prominently in the premolar region, you will have this transverse line on the premolar region, but you have to have this oblique line from which direction to which direction it is going is very important. Okay, now this transverse line on the radiograph in the premolar region is a nasolabial fold. When you have this type of radio opacity, you have to think in all the directions, and judge the you have to go clinically also and see whether the patient is having prominent nasolabial fold or not. Then coming to the posterior landmarks, can you see the pterygoid plates? These are the pterygoid plate, that is medial and lateral pterygoid plate, but here the medial pterygoid plate will be seen prominently, and the process, hamular process, which is extending to inferior to the medial pterygoid plate, and these landmarks are present posterior to the maxillary tuberosity. This is maxillary tuberosity. Now, can we have this is a zygomatic process? This is line is a floor of maxillary sinus. This is maxillary tuberosity. these posterior landmarks, these are the medial pterygoid plate. This inferior extension is the hamular process. Now here though I have not mentioned one landmark because it is going to come in the mandibular landmark. Now we'll be dealing in detail with that. What is this structure? What is this structure? Because it is appearing in the maxillary region, but it is not of a maxilla, I am not considering here. But for you students, this is a coronoid process of a mandible. This is a coronoid process of mandible because you will concern that what is, ma'am has not told this structure. And so this is a structure which is of a mandible. So I have not considered here in the landmark of a maxilla. So I think I have given the enough separation of a maxillary and the mandibular landmarks, maxillary landmark, radiopaque and radiolucent. And the structures are very simple to understand. If you go from anterior region, we'll have just we'll go from one by one. That is intermaxillary suture, anterior nasal spine, the nasal aperture, incisive foramen, superior foramina of nasopalatine canal, then lateral fossa, nose, nasolacrimal canal, maxillary sinus, zygomatic process, zygomatic bone, nasolabial fold and pterygoid plates. Now, amongst these, the radio-opaque landmark, it is anterior nasal spine, yes. Then the floor of maxillary sinus, yes. Zygomatic process and zygomatic bone, yes. The nasolabial fold, the pterygoid plate, maxillary tuberosity, the hamular process. What are radiolucent one? The radiolucent one is the intermaxillary suture, then nasal aperture, then we'll have the incisive foramen, the superior foramina of a nasopalatine canal, the lateral fossa, diffuse radiolucency, the shadow of nose is diffuse radioopacity. There are two landmarks only which are soft tissue, that is nose and the nasolabial fold. Then nasolacrimal canal is again the soft tissue landmark. Maxillary sinus itself is a radiolucent one. And so there is this difference. Whenever there is a soft tissue structures, you will have to have soft tissue structures plus the air which is present in the maxillary sinus like structures. It will appear as a radiolucency. And in case of an calcified structures like bone, mineralized structures, calcified structures, they will appear as a radio-opacity. And so to conclude, knowledge about the normal radiographic landmark is very important to interpret radiograph. Now there are age-wise, gender-wise and region-wise variations that should be considered whenever we are interpreting a radiograph. Thank you.